Choose your fighter. Air shock. Coil shock.
I think I'm gonna go with coil shock, actually.
Really, dude? You?
Yeah. I'm Spencer.
I'm Bruce.
This is Shop Talk.
Spencer, I am shocked.
Ah, good one.
Absolutely shocked that you are riding a coil shock now. I mean, you are such an XC nerd. How can you ride anything but air?
Good question, Bruce. I've been riding an Orbea Occam LT lately. It's equipped with a Fox DHX coil shock, and what can I say? The proof is in the ride. It's super smooth on choppy, rough terrain, works great with the suspension design. For trail bikes, for enduro bikes, I think I might be sold on the coil shock.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of coil shocks. You know, both of us now at this point have tried both.
We have.
Maybe it's time for you to think about trying a coil shock. I mean, there's a lot of pros and cons for each.
Yeah, let's dive into it, and maybe this will help you decide if you want to be a little coil curious.
Let's start off with air shocks. These are the most common shocks you'll find on mountain bikes. They're super popular, and what's great is that the air spring is infinitely adjustable. You can use a shock pump and set it up for any weight rider, lightweight, heavyweight. And also the shock itself is a lot lighter than a coil shock.
Exactly. There's no way you'd ever find a coil shock on a cross-country bike, for instance, and it's pretty much de facto standard for trail bikes as well. Now, there are some downsides to the air shock. First and foremost, it tends to heat up on extended rough descents, and this will affect the way damping behaves. And also, there's a lot more seals in this little guy compared to a coil shock, so there's more stiction. That means the shock is not as supple and smooth because there's just more friction in the system.
Now with an air shock, you have a lot more seals. You gotta seal the damper inside the shock, and you gotta seal the air inside the shock too.
Gotta be airtight, Bruce. So you got this, you got this. It adds up to create more stiction that makes the shock, requires more force to break into the travel.
Whereas a coil shock, really all you need to seal is the damper.
These little guys don't cause too much stiction now, do they?
Yeah.
It also should be noted that, as you can see, this one, much larger diameter than that one. Less surface area, again, less stiction to overcome. It's very noticeable right away when you check out a bike, you give it the BMX handshake. So supple off the top. Air shocks are great, super high tech, but it's hard to match the suppleness of a coil spring.
Oh yeah. I gotta push, you know, to break through that little first bit right there. Yeah.
Stiction. Coil shock. Bruce, give me some pros.
Well, not surprisingly, it's going to be kind of the opposite of the air shock. It's going to heat up less, especially on long, rough descents, so the damping stays really consistent. And also, because there's fewer seals, there's less stiction. It feels really supple, really nice, especially on small bumps. It kind of just erases them, smooths everything out.
Definitely, Bruce. Now, there are some cons, and as you might guess, they're kind of the antithesis of the advantages of an air shock. So the coil spring, you have to physically remove it and put a different one on to change the spring rate based on your body weight. And sometimes you're in between spring weights, you know, a tweener. You don't want that. It's also plain to see that it's a heavier thing to put on your bike. I mean, you can feel it when you pick it up. It's a steel coil that's, it's just gonna be heavier than air. That's science.
Science rules.
It's got a linear spring rate. That's typically how coils operate. Air shocks are more progressive. Now, bike engineers usually accommodate for that in their design, but it's worth noting. So an air shock, it goes like something like that.
Yeah, so as you get deeper into the travel, the more force is required to compress that spring.
This helps avoid a really harsh bottom out, like if you're going off a big drop off.
Yeah, while a coil spring, you know, it's linear, so it kind of just goes like this.
A line. Go figure.
Yeah, but you need a bike that has a sort of progressive suspension design to be able to compensate for this linear spring rate. Otherwise, you're going to be hitting the bottom a lot.
Right. So off the shelf, bikes are usually designed correctly, depending on whether it's an air shock or a coil shock and whatever suspension mm-hmm. design you have. Where you might run into trouble is if you replace an air shock with a coil shock or vice versa.
Yeah, so make sure, do your research.
Shay, you're our suspension tech here.
Yes.
Coil shocks or air shocks for mountain bike?
I prefer the feel of a coil.
Is there a certain amount of travel that's like the minimum for a coil shock? Because obviously an XC bike, you're not gonna have a coil shock on that.
Yeah, I would say probably maybe one sub 130 mil of travel. You probably wouldn't gain any benefit from having a coil shock anymore.
One more demo for you guys. We want to show you how heat affects damping on an air shock versus a coil shock.
Yeah, let's go to the TPC laboratory.
Come on, let's find some beakers that we can use now.
For our purposes, this is going to demonstrate what happens to your damper oil when it gets hot on a long, rough descent.
Pour it into this bad boy.
Yeah, so, you know.
If you can.
When it's cool, you've heard the saying, right? Slow as molasses, look at that.
Oh yeah, look at all the damping action happening right now.
Lovely, that's slow, controlled.
That's good.
Yeah, you're gonna make it down the mountain.
The air shock, by nature, the air heats up mm-hmm. due to the friction of compression.
Yep.
And that heats up the damping oil.
Exactly.
Whereas on a coil shock, the coil spring is independent of the damping, so whatever minor heat is generated, it is not transferred to the damping oil. Now, we just went down a long, rocky descent.
Tread the gnars, some rock gardens, some drops to flat.
Oh, my shock feels so messed up. What's wrong with my shock? Oh, I'm going over the bars.
Oh, it's too fast.
Oh, my God.
Your rebound's too fast. Your compression has just gone out the window. Yeah.
So that's the problem with air shocks.
Yeah. Have you ever burned yourself on an air shock?
No.
I have.
I wear leathers usually. I hope this helped you guys. Coil spring, air spring, whatever it is, Bruce, we should be counting our blessings because at least it's not elastomer spring.
Yeah. What we have here, this is Travis Brown's 1991 Manitou race bike.
Mountain bike history. Maybe not the pinnacle of suspension technology.
Yeah, it's actually one of the earliest full suspension mountain bikes. What they did is they took a Manitou fork and put it on the seat stays there.
And as is the case, both fork and rear suspension, you've got elastomer springs.
Mm-hmm.
Elastomers are just these little rubber pucks, and they just put them in the forks. No hydraulic damping to speak of, at least not in this fork. And you just rely on the plastics inherent damping characteristics to sort of kind of work.
Sounds bouncy.
And if you thought the oil in your suspension got a little slow and a little bit muted feeling on a cold day, then the elastomer pretty much will freeze solid on you. So count your blessings, Bruce.
I think I'll stick to my modern coil shock.
I think I will too. But we'd love to hear what you've got to say. So leave us a comment whether you like air shocks or coil shocks.
Yeah, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and thanks for watching.
See you next time.
Do your research.
Yeah, don't try this at home, kids.
Or do try it at home.
Yeah, fuck it, why not? Test your luck.